so what else? We've been doing the Albany Hill Cross, as you know. Brian, in particular, has been very involved. Hi, Brian. Brian's done a lot of work, a lot of council meetings, talking with council people. He's a citizen of Albany. It's been a huge amount of work that's put in, and at this point, we basically have the city council agreeing with us, and the city council had about a month ago turned off all the electricity to the cross, and so far the Lions Club, I think they're getting legal national advice because they haven't tried to get a permit to put electrical service in, and I think they know the city's going to fight them. So it's finally gotten down to the point where it looks like at least that thing won't be lit anymore. It's a 25-foot steel cross in a city park. They light it up in the holidays, so everybody knows that Albany's a good Christian town. So anyway, that's on its way out, and it's been quite a fight. And you know, we've used a lot of tactics and tried to be flexible. And it's a very different thing when you have a city council that's not the bad guys. They basically agree with everything you say about the establishment of church and state. You know, it's just they don't want to get sued by the Lions Club, who has the easement for the thing. So anyway, okay, let's go on then. I guess that's pretty much it. Oh, next month we're going to have Dan Arel. He's a blogger, author. Recently wrote a book on secular activism, and before that he wrote a best-selling book on atheist parenting beyond belief, I believe. So I look forward to having him. Hope we'll get people. So anyway, so let's turn off our cell phones, and today we're proud to host Aron Ra. He's the new president of Atheist Alliance, maybe what, 2 months?
Yeah, something like that.
Yeah. Very prominent atheist activist, blogger, podcaster from Austin.
Dallas.
Dallas. Oh, yeah, I thought you were from Austin. Okay, see?
I wish I was from Austin.
I was going to say.
Yeah. Yeah, actually, I understand. I've been in Austin. Spent a little time. speaking on the fundamental fallacies of faith, and this is a promotion for his book, which will be available today for $17. Foundational Falsehoods of Creationism, which is I think you'll find from the talk and everything else. He very succinctly creates some very strong philosophically and scientifically based arguments to use against creationists and in general to use against theists. So please help welcome Aron.
Thank you. I hope you don't mind that I forego the jacket. It seems to be informal here. I prefer it that way. You know, I'm supposed to have a more professional presentation, but it's hot. Are you okay? Can you hear me okay?
No.
You can't? Wow, we had a mic at the last one. They didn't.
No, we didn't. We don't usually have a mic here either.
I'll just project. I'll just make sure that you can hear.
Fan.
All right.
Can everybody hear that? Oh, their fan? Yeah, would that help if we turn the fan on?
I wouldn't want to turn off the fan. No, we don't need to take extreme measures.
Well, the thing is, we've got an open door, too.
Okay.
Let's see how it works.
All right. So I'm promoting a book that I wrote, Foundational Falsehoods of Creationism. I want to first give you a little bit of background on what that came from. I was offered a challenge by a friend of mine who was upset that she saw me wearing a Darwin Fish t-shirt. And she said that you can't prove evolutionism. And I thought, well, just the fact that you call it that betrays what the problem is. But yes, I can prove evolution. And she said, well, do it then. I said, well, I can't do it right here standing in the parking lot of a Dairy Queen, but if you give me some time, I'll create a presentation of the facts and get that to you so that we'll convince you to your satisfaction. And she says, you can't prove evolution because to do that you'd have to disprove God. And I said, whether God exists or not is irrelevant. And she staggered backward at that thought. But that's really the truth, though. I mean, whether God exists or not, the Bible is still a collection of man-made fables, and evolution is still a demonstrable, inescapable fact of population genetics. So what I did was I created a series of videos that reflect what I had seen myself when I was debating people online. I spent a great deal of time, an unhealthy amount of my life, online on places like Usenet, like alt.talk.creationism and talk.origins and sites like that. And I argued with what I thought were the experts in both sides of the story. I would throw out my question, I would see them both answer it, and they of course can see their own answer. So I have evolutionary biologists and I have theologians arguing with themselves over the questions that I throw out. And then whatever they tell me that I should read, whatever research they think I should do, I did, because I had the time to do that back then. But what I found was that in the more arguments that I got with these people, there's like a handful of the same arguments kept recurring again and again. There's no transitional species, there's no beneficial mutations, you know, this argument, that argument, you know, evolution's a fraud because, you know, built-down man, whatever. I got to see the same thing over and over again. So what I did was I created a video series that would address these type of these each one of these categories of complaints as I listed them. I found that when I was debating people online that I wasn't even writing new material anymore. I'm just cutting and pasting what I had explained to the previous person. And at some points the previous person was the same person I'm still talking to. And why aren't they learning? Why are you saying this when you know this isn't the case? So when you adopt religion or the religious perspective on creationism, I mean, you don't have to know anything about science, you don't have to know about anything about history or theology or philosophy or any damn thing. You have people coming to your door. You go to church twice a week. You have the tracts, the religious tracts, stuck under your windshield wipers. You know, and you don't have to have any background information, they just tell you to believe in magic and you're supposed to accept that. But in order to get the evolutionary perspective, because we don't have people standing on soapboxes in most cases, I did meet one in Hyde Park in England. There was one guy standing on a soapbox preaching evolution. I thought that was a novel thing. I had to take a picture with it because it was so outrageous. But for the most part, most of us don't have that. In order to understand evolution or accept evolution, you have to kind of understand it. It's not something where we request that you believe it, even if you don't understand it. Most rational people would rather you not accept it if you don't understand it, and only accept it if you do. Right? You have to have a reason why you believe the things that you do, not simply because some authority told you to. But in order to understand evolution, you had to have a great deal of investment of your own time and money. You had to have a certain amount of aptitude. You had to have the interest. You had to have finances. You had to be able to study. You had to have a great deal of investment of money and so forth to understand evolution, where, of course, none of that is required for creationism. So what I tried to do was create a video series that would address those without a great background in science, those who didn't know a lot of the peripheral information, maybe don't even have a whole lot of time or even much of attention span, just little 10-minute videos to explain each of these arguments. And as I said, I came up with categories, 15 categories of foundational falsehoods of creationism, the ideas, the false ideas that creationism is fundamentally based on. And the first one being the one that girl just brought up, that you either had to accept the Bible exactly verbatim as, you know, as Ray Comfort would accept it, and disregard not only every other, let's say, more nuanced, more experienced, more educated, more learned versions of theology, and everybody else's theology too. All other religions, for example, can be discarded in the atheist category, and I've actually seen that argument, where Christians would identify Muslims as atheists because they don't buy their version, right? Any other doctrine is categorized in that same disbelief category. So the second, before I finish off this one, that first foundational falsehood of creationism is a false dichotomy also, obviously, because you had many of the pioneers in evolutionary biology, and many of the leading voices in evolutionary biology still have been or still are Christian. And there are people of many other religions who also accept the evolutionary. They can accept the science, they can also hold on to their religious beliefs. Sometimes they will even say that they have traditional religious beliefs, like Ken Miller, the star witness in Kissmiller versus Dover, identified as a traditional Christian. And yet, he's also a textbook evolutionary author, so it is not the false dichotomy that they make it out to be. The second foundational falsehood of creationism is the idea that the scripture is the word of God. That somehow or other, even though the Bible attributes all of its books to human authors and human prophets pretending to speak for God, we are now supposed to reinterpret that, where even the original authors didn't seem to interpret it as if they were talking for God. It doesn't seem, when you read the Bible, that any of these people thought that they were speaking for God unless they were prophets, you know, unless they were prophets, and then the prophets only have certain moments when they say, this is what God revealed to me. But now, in the modern day, we're supposed to accept that everything that came into the Bible was written by God directly through these other people. Even when we have a half a dozen books in the New Testament and a half a dozen books in the Old Testament that have been deleted, omitted by human editors, and were obviously written by human authors. Yet, the Bible still makes reference to them. That's how we know that they were once supposed to be or intended to be part of the canon or the collective theology on this matter. Why would God write a book that refers to other works that were written by human authors? Or if these, all of these were supposed to be written by God, why would God refer to people to read books that no longer exist? They're not just not part of the canon anymore. They're not available at all. Nobody's seen them. Maybe someday some archaeologists will happen across one of them, but for right now, all these other books that are listed supposed to be part of the canon, and they're just lost. Clearly, God was not the editor. God is not preserving his word. God is not writing these things. This is another false statement. The third foundational falsehood of creationism is the idea that human interpretation of scripture is somehow absolute truth. That you can't question anything about their interpretation, whatever the Bible says, the way that they, not just actually what the Bible says, because there's a lot of places where Christians will read between the lines and then ignore the lines. And I have several examples of that, like for example, the Satan being depicted as, the serpent being depicted as Satan. That didn't happen. We know that wasn't the case. The cover of this book shows a detail from Notre Dame Cathedral where the serpent is represented as a woman. And of course, on the ceiling of the Sistine Chapel, Michelangelo depicted the serpent as a woman. So we know that was the mainstream Catholic perspective at one time. Now, it's never written anywhere that the serpent was supposed to be a woman or who that woman was, but then it's not written anywhere that it was supposed to be the devil either. These are legends. Now, there's a Talmudic legend that the serpent was actually supposed to be Lilith. That's the first wife of Adam. And I'm going on a side road, but he did tell me that he wanted me to take a little bit longer, so I hope you'll indulge me. Lilith was supposed to be Adam's first wife, and there's a couple of different creation stories for her. One of them is that God created Adam and Eve simultaneously, and so they were both equal, and then Lilith escaped somehow, and we'll get to that in a moment, and then God created a second woman out of his rib. Or in another version, and these are just legends, these are not actually written down as supposed to be canon anywhere. But the other one is that Adam witnessed the creation of Eve, and this freaked him out because he saw a woman that didn't have skin. And so God had to put him under anesthetic somehow and pull a rib out of him and do that magic trick. But the story with Lilith is that being equal to Adam, she didn't want to be subservient. Specifically, she didn't want to be on bottom. So she happened to know God's own real name, and this gave her magic powers, and it gave her the ability to fly. And so she flew out of the garden, where she then supposedly had an orgy with a bunch of demons on the shores of the Red Sea, and is now the mother of all vampires, and other sorts of legends have been attributed to her. But this is who Eve is, or the serpent is supposed to be. And one of the sources for this is the story of Lilith in the Epic of Gilgamesh, where God himself is played by the character Gilgamesh. He's walking through the garden, and Gilgamesh happens across Lilith, who is in the sacred tree, or the forbidden tree, with the serpent who cannot be tamed, and that is her companion. And it's only ever supposed to be a snake. Now, we see parallels like this, we understand that this is where the Bible comes from, right? And we kind of see all these collective disjointed legends being blended together, and that this is the source of this legend. And if I could cover anything else on Lilith. Oh, yes. Lilith was depicted not just on the Notre Dame Cathedral, and not just in the Sistine Chapel, but by all of the great Renaissance artists. All of the Christian Renaissance artists depicted the serpent as a woman. There's at least, I think, 18 examples of this. There's one anomaly where somebody else depicted the serpent as having a beard with a crown. Again, no explanation as to who that was supposed to be. But we know that it can't be the devil. And I say that the Bible doesn't say that it's the devil. You're reading between the lines and just throwing in your own interpretation on it. But then somebody else says, well, yeah, in Revelations it says that the devil is that old serpent and a dragon. Well, indeed it does say that. And Jesus says that the Pharisees are the sons of Satan and that they are vipers. But he's saying they're snakes and that they're the sons of devils. But he doesn't mean that they're literally the devil, nor that they're literally the son of the devil. And when Revelations talks about the serpent, you know, the Satan being that old serpent, it's that old serpent with seven heads standing on the beach. The Bible's reference to the serpent, apparently, doesn't say very clearly, but we can presume it doesn't have seven heads. It's one of those details you think it might bring up. But it doesn't. Instead, the serpent is doomed to crawl on his belly for all the rest of his days. But the serpent in Revelation is standing. How's that possible? And the first time we see Satan represented by name is in a story chronologically after Genesis, where Satan is walking. It says very clearly that he's walking, and he's chatting with God as if they were old friends that never had a falling out. So clearly, he's not crawling on his belly all the rest of his days. And when the story of Genesis is talking about the grandfather of all snakes, and Satan is clearly a different character with a different path, and these legends were just kind of blended together for convenience. But now it's treated as if it were absolute truth, and we know that it can't be. And this is also in that chapter, I also do a lot about comparative religions, because we also hear people profess, you know, that for one example, and this one girl was talking about how her life in Thailand, she says her life was completely turned around when she finally accepted Buddha in her life. And it just sounds exactly like what you hear about Christian testimonies. You know, any religion can make the same sort of testimony. The fourth foundational falsehood is the idea that belief equals knowledge. That if you really, really, really believe it, if you're really convinced, that's the same thing as knowing it. As if you know it in your heart. As if that has any significance, because it doesn't. Nobody knows anything in their heart. Knowledge is demonstrable. It's testable with measurable accuracy. Knowledge is a subset of belief, but it's justified belief, meaning you can show that it's true. I can say that I know that the Bible says X, but until you can show that it does, you don't really know that. And if you show that it does, then you knew that. But if you look up in the Bible, this has happened to me several times, I know that it said, I remember that incorrectly, I guess. So that's what we think about, you know, your personal anecdotal certainties. The fifth foundational falsehood of creationism talks a little bit about the history of the United States being called a Christian nation, or supposedly being founded as a Christian nation. The falsehood here is that evolution is a religion, just like creationism is. And of course, there have been court rulings and other discussions on how do they treat humanism, for example, with regard to religion. How is atheism treated as a religion? What is a religion? What constitutes or qualifies as a religion? And so forth. And of course, there's a great deal against the evidence that I put in against the claim that the United States was founded as a Christian nation. Certainly not. And I think I've got a really strong argument for that. And there's no argument that I've seen to the counter. And not one that takes anything that I say into account. On the sixth foundational falsehood of creationism, there's a continuation of the evolutionism theme. And this is where evolution has to replace God. And it's supposed to account for everything that they used to attribute to God. So that evolution is no longer a theory of biodiversity. It now has to account for the origin of life, the universe, and everything. Just as they used to do with God. In fact, I've got some notes I've got to pull up here. What are we up to? Seven Okay, the seventh foundation, and I also have to talk in the sixth chapter, I have to talk about what the Big Bang is, because they bundled that up into the evolutionism thing too. And we have to talk about what abiogenesis is. We have to talk about how there are systemic problems against people understanding these things. If you look up, for example, in any common dictionary, if you look up abiogenesis, the common layman dictionary will tell you, all of them will tell you, that abiogenesis is spontaneous generation, that they are the same thing, and that it was disproved by Louis Pasteur, you know, a couple hundred years ago. But that's not the case. We know that these are two completely different theories with different origins. They posit different things. One was disproved by using scientific methodology, disproved by an evolutionist, by the way, because Louis Pasteur accepted at least Lamarckian evolution. He certainly wasn't a creationist. But you can't get the dictionaries to change their stance on this. Even when I've explained to a couple of them what the different definitions are and how we know that, they're not going to correct it. They know that they're misleading people, and they don't care. And that's the bigger problem here. The seventh foundational falsehood of creationism is the idea that evolution is random. And with random being, in their perspective, that it's not designed with a predetermined purpose, because they want to believe that they are the reason that the universe exists, that everything was created just for us, that the earth was somehow the first thing that ever existed in the universe, that God somehow spent 4 days working on this one rock and then sneezed out the entirety of the rest of the cosmos in a single moment, and then spent 2 more days working on this one rock again. Because this one rock is obviously the biggest and most complicated and most important thing there is. And those trillions of other galaxies are nothing. Now, just the idea that the Earth was supposed to be the first of anything, clearly, the Bible was written by people who didn't understand what the nature of the earth is or its relation to anything or else in the cosmos. The eighth foundational falsehood of creationism, and I'm sure I'm missing something. The eighth foundational falsehood of creationism is the claim that that there's never been a beneficial mutation. A beneficial mutation meaning, of course, they'll argue that you have deletion mutations, and that's a loss of information. Right? Or you have fusion of two chromosomes in one chromosome, and that also, again, is a loss of information. And they won't define for you what information is. They have this logical fallacy that they can't ever define what information is, because the minute they do, then we'll disprove it, because for their subtraction mutations, we have duplication mutations. We have an opposite for everything that they conclude. But they'll say confidently that it takes more information to create a bird than it does a dinosaur. But they can't tell you how much it takes in either case, so how can they verify which is really more? Nor can they explain how it is that dinosaurs are now indistinguishable from birds, having so many of them with feathers. This is another thing they can't admit to. And so that becomes a fraud that we've perpetuated. On that same note, the ninth foundational falsehood of creationism is the claim that transitional species have never been found in the fossil record. When they found Archaeopteryx, for example, one of the samples of Archaeopteryx that they found didn't have feather impressions, it was just the skeleton, so it was identified by its skeleton as being a dinosaur, unambiguously. They just clearly identified that as being a dinosaur. When they realized that it actually was an Archaeopteryx, then it was accused of being fraudulent. There was a couple of scientists who said that Archaeopteryx was a coelophysis with feathers glued onto it as part of this great scam that evolution, big science, was trying to perpetuate against believers in order to fool them. And usually when they talk about transitional species, they talk about things like a half giraffe, half fish, or something, or a crocoduck. It's what they're usually looking for. So they don't accept what a transitional species would actually be. Now there's the general definition that a lot of people accept, that everything is a transitional species, that we all are transitional species. But there's a more specific definition that is more restrictive. And so only certain species will qualify. These are species that have certain characteristics of lineage A, certain characteristics of lineage B, you know, intermediate steps between the two, and how they're found in the fossil record and so forth. So there's a number of criteria that you have to meet in order to make in order to be unambiguously a transitional species, not just a general species. And I found a creationist website, a young earth creationist website, that posted a scientific definition, the restrictive scientific definition of what a transitional species is, and it's the same definition that scientists use. So I got in touch with the microbiologist, PhD, who was running this young earth creationist website, and I said, okay, here are the criteria for transitional species. I agree this is a scientifically appropriate and accurate description. Now here are 300 or 400 examples of other species who exactly fit every criteria you've laid out. Do you admit that any of these exist? And he refused to accept that any of them meet the definition that he put down, because he said that would require that he assume that transitional evolution happened, which of course it doesn't require that. It just doesn't meet these criteria. You know, but he won't admit that because of another logical fallacy, which is called the slippery slope. If you admit one, then that means you have to admit more, so they will lie about this. And I got more direct evidence of that when I did a moderated debate with somebody that was hosting or courting the Board of Education. He wanted to teach the strengths and weaknesses of evolution, and one of the weaknesses that he proposed was that there were no transitional species in the fossil record. In our moderated debate, he admitted in writing before the moderators that he knew that there were, in fact, transitional species in the fossil record, but that he wanted to teach students that there were none because he said it was important that they believe there are none. So he admits on public record that it's okay to lie to other people's children in public education for the express purpose of misleading them to manipulate their beliefs. Yeah. The 10th foundational falsehood of creationism is one that's very particular to me. This is the claim that the tree of life is not real, that it is an illusion, that it's not actually indicated by anything in biology. Now, there are a number of specific traits that people can use to identify different life forms. I mean, there are criteria for mammals, for example, you know, that distinguish mammals from other vertebrates, from other nathostomes, from other coelomates, and so forth. There's all these different categories. And when you study the categories, it does flesh out a tree like this. It is the most compelling argument there is for evolution, and it's so compelling that it could actually prove evolution even if we'd never found a single fossil. And a demonstration of that is creationists will often say that Charles Darwin had admitted that or there was no transitional species in his time. Okay, fine, in his time. He predicted they would be found in the future, and they lie about whether we found them because we found buckets of them. But let's forget what we found since Darwin's day, and even while Darwin was still alive. Let's just go to his prediction that there would be transitional species found. How did he predict that there would be? What was the evidence? If they didn't have any transitional species then, how did he know that there would be in the future? It's because of phylogeny. It's because of taxonomy. It's the classification of life forms. As I said, this is the most compelling argument there is for evolution, and I've got a couple of videos about this. One of them called the Phylogeny Challenge, wherein anybody who wants to posit that there's any truth at all to creationism, or if there's any significant flaw to evolution, then it will be found in taxonomy, because there has to be a place where there are created kinds. For example, I went to Noah's Ark in Kentucky. And we had to argue with the people up there about their interpretation of kinds and baramens. Baramens are what the creationists try to come up with to deny science and put it in a spin toward creationism. What they said is that all of the millions of species that we have on the Earth today were not all on Noah's Ark. But instead, all of the millions of species we have today were derived from 1,400 original created kinds. And these original created kinds are in a classification that they've made up called baramens. They don't have an example of baramens, nor can they ever. So I made a video on called the Phylogeny Challenge, which explains how they need to be able to produce two or three examples of baramens, of created kinds, that we can identify that these are, and you have descendant branches that are all related from these original stock, but that these original stock are not themselves related to each other, because they can't be, not if they're special creations. And I walked through Noah's Ark with one of the people that works at Answers in Genesis, and one of the things that they had on display was Pachycetus, the dawn whale. It's the most beautiful rendering of a Pachycetus that's ever been done. and I can't use my pictures of it because it's in a cage. You can't see past the bars to see the whole animal. I asked them to present, give me a photo that somebody took of this piece of artwork before they put it in the cage. Because this, I want to put it to scientific application. It is a beautiful rendering. It could do some good for somebody, but not here on the boat where its only intention is to lie to people. And why would you put the Dawn whale on an ark? If we have whales in the ocean, there'd be no reason to put one on an ark, right? And so if you want to argue that all of these created kinds come from, or all of these numerous species now come from original created kinds, why would you put Mary Chippus on there, which is a middle horse in the lineage of horses? It's the one, it's not the one that has four or five toes, it's one that has three toes, and the three toes still touch the ground, and then later horses, you have only one toe touch the ground, and the two other toes are up. And then, of course, modern horses have only the one toe, and all of the other toes are residual, and no longer exist. I'm trying to explain all of this to somebody who refuses to understand what he believes, which I think is interesting. You maintain a belief, and you make sure you don't understand it, because that's the only way you can believe it. So then the next thing we look at is the velociraptors, and I have to, yeah, because there's velociraptors on Noah's Ark. And I have to point out that all dromaeosaurids had feathers. Where are their feathers? And of course, there's another thing they can't admit to, because there's another diagnostic trait that keeps the bird kind separate from the beast kind. And what the hell is the bird kind? Because even when you look at the Bible, that doesn't offer any help, because it talks about different kinds of birds. So bird is a parent category of multiple kinds. What kind of classification system is that? And then it gets even more confusing by mentioning multiple sorts of birds. Is a sort the same sort of a kind? Doesn't say. The way the Bible classifies things is by what they do rather than what they are. So at one point, bats are birds because they fly. And at another point, bats are locusts because they swarm. So, and of course, shellfish are fish because they live in the water, and so are whales. So whales and lobster are the same kind. None of that makes any sense at all. But the reason I said it's personal to me, when we got into Patreon, I mean, I was working a regular job in a cube farm. If anybody saw the movie The Incredibles, the cartoon movie, the superhero family, Mr. Incredible's job, he sits in a cube farm denying little old ladies their insurance coverage. That was me for 15 years. I was so happy to get out of that job. I tell you, if I was not already an atheist, that job would have convinced me that there's no such thing as a soul. But I had this conversation with my boss then, which is why he's not my boss now, where he wanted to argue creationism and starts asking me this volley of questions. And, you know, well, actually, that, I should probably talk about that later, because it matches something else I'm going to go into. So I won't, so I'll hold back on that. I got out of this job, and I got into Patreon. So that the way that I fund all my activities, so this is to put the pitch out, patreon.com/ARONRA. People sign up to donate $1 or more per video. And I make a half a dozen videos a week, so half a dozen videos a month. So after a month, your credit card would be charged for $6, and I can use all the support I can get. There's a number of things that we do with that. My wife is a science teacher, middle school science teacher, and a curriculum specialist with the Next Generation Science Standards. She writes the scripts for classroom supplement science videos that we put out for teachers to use in the classroom, teaching unapologetically. All of the things that students are supposed to be taught and tested on according to the National Science Standards, but also including evolution wherever it is supposed to be there, and where many teachers will skim over that. And I'll talk more about that later. It will probably be in the Q&A. But one of the other projects that we've done is the Phylogeny Explorer Project, which is where we are rendering the entire tree of life as a navigable online encyclopedia of biology. Not of the individual species, but talking about the importance of all the clades to which they belong. And I'll give you an example of that. Deuterostomes. Most animals, start off with a cluster of cells before they have any kind of traits at all, no organs or any distinguishing features. The very first thing they develop is a hole in this ball of cells called a blastopore, a hole that runs through and joins out on the other end so that it becomes hollow. In most other animals, it starts out with the mouth and ends up in an anus, and of course becomes a digestive tract as it develops. But in higher animals, including mammals, including us, the opening that arises first is the anus. It develops kind of backwards. Yeah, it's anus first, and then that hole develops all the way out into the mouth. But for a moment, there is a time when we are literally nothing but assholes. And this is one of the traits that we can classify life forms on. So one of the things that we're doing is the Phylogeny Explorer Project, which is illustrating this 10th foundational falsehood of creationism, showing how the tree of life is actually indicated in biology, certainly. And the next one, this is the 11th foundational falsehood of creationism, is the claim that macroevolution has never been observed. And macroevolution, they use a straw man argument misrepresenting what macroevolution is. They want it to be a tree giving birth to a moth. They want it to be a fish deciding to grow legs because it wants to go for a walk. And of course, they're talking about individuals. One person actually told it to me this way. They thought that evolution was, or that macroevolution was, one group of bacteria gathered together to become a man, and another group gathered together to become a fish. That's how grotesque the misunderstanding is. And a fellow activist, Zach Copland, tried to give a testimony in Louisiana when their state passed some loophole so that they can teach creationism in public schools. And he's giving a testimony to show that macroevolution has been demonstrated, that the difference between these, microevolution is variation within species, macroevolution is variation between species, and that of course includes the speciation, the emergence of a new species. Creationists have to misrepresent what that is, right? So they have to come up with their created kinds thing so they can go back to this other narrative that doesn't make any sense. But Zach Copland was giving a testimony where he talked about a new species of bacteria that emerged under direct observation in controlled conditions in a lab. The senator taking his testimony stopped him and said, but did it turn into a person? So this is how grotesque the willful misunderstanding is on the part of the creationists. And of course I give you several examples of various types of macroevolution that have been verified, that have occurred under direct observation. There's actually three or four different categories of species, macroevolution, that have all been documented. The 12th foundational falsehood gets a little bit into history, talking about how creation science, were separated from actual science. And it is the foundational falsehood here is that creationism is somehow scientific. And this, in a sense, began with Sir Richard Owen, who was the foremost authority on paleontology in the entire world at that time, but he was also a creationist. And this caused him a disturbing position. It was an awkward position for him because he can't refute what he knows better than everybody else. He's not going to deny the geologic column, for example, like modern creationists deny that there even is a geologic column. He knows there's a geologic column, so there's no point in trying to lie to himself about that. So he had to come up with a whole different rationale for how to explain things to get away from evolution. Even though Darwin hadn't yet proposed evolution, Lamarck had. And a number of other people had proposed that one way or another, new species could arise. And look, Owen refused to accept that. Instead, he said that God would create new and improved designs by learning from his mistakes when the old designs wore out. So he thought that iguanodons and megalosaurs and things like that were once vast, efficient, and long-enduring creatures, but that they degraded to become these sluggish, barely operable things like crocodiles that we have today. And so those old designs had to be replaced by newer, faster mammals. And that's why he imagined that pterosaurs had been replaced by birds, that there's no relationship there, that these are special creations and that God just comes out with a new and improved model occasionally. The 13th foundational falsehood of creationism is the claim that evolution is a fraud. And there again, get into a little bit of history where we talk about Piltdown Man and Nebraska Man and Archaeoraptor and things like that. And the claim here is that evolution is part of some global conspiracy that's been going on for hundreds of years, where all of the scientists and all of the universities are secretly in on it. And they have this goal to fool people into not believing in God anymore. as if any of that makes any sense, as if any of that would work, as if we are all supposed to believe in God, we're supposed to know that God exists, and we're lying about that so that we love, because we love sin, we want to be able to sin, and we don't want to have authority ruling over us. But one thing we could easily figure out is just, if you pretend that God doesn't exist, that doesn't mean that he doesn't exist. If you think there's a God, the only thing that really pisses God off is when you don't believe in him. So why would we say that we don't believe in him? We already know that it doesn't matter how evil you are. All sins can be forgiven if you but believe. So if you have sin, confess, believe in Jesus Christ. Because it doesn't matter if you don't believe, it doesn't matter how good you are. Because the only sin that will not be forgiven is the sin of disbelief. So that gullibility is the sole criteria for redemption. So there's no reason that we would want to pretend that God exists. There's no reason we would come up for any of these lies. And I go through the list of all of the claims that they make about Piltdown Man, Nebraska Brain, and so forth, and show that in detail, there's not a case, there's not a single moment where you can point to a professional evolutionary biologist who ever lied in the course of promoting evolution over creationism. There's not one example like that in history. Now, there's plenty of examples of scientists who lie. And I can think of several, and I didn't list some in this chapter. There are professional scientists who lie and get away with it. But there's not one who lies for evolution against creationism. There's no need to. Conversely, there is also not one example of a professional creationist who did not lie while promoting creationism over evolution. And I make both of these challenges in the same chapter. The fourth foundational falsehood of creationism is the claim that there is no evidence of divine, or excuse me, that there is evidence of divine miraculous creation. The evidence, however, is whatever you can't explain is somehow explained by magic. So whatever science doesn't explain, we got, right? As if they're the default position, as if not being able to explain something, as if the unexplained means explained and explained by magic. And this is where my boss was talking to me. He asks a question that he thinks an evolutionist can't answer, and I start to answer it. And so he interrupts the answer to ask another question. I start to answer that. He interrupts that answer to ask another question. And he continues doing this. He knows I have the answer. He doesn't care. He doesn't want to know what the answer is. He wants to keep asking questions until he comes to one that I can't answer. So when he gets to one where he says, what happened before the Big Bang? And before I can explain to him why that is a meaningless question, because it's like asking what's south of the South Pole, he says, well, you see, you come to a point where you can't answer. And I had to explain to him, you don't even acknowledge it. I did answer every question you asked up to this point. And not only did I have the answers, but let's notice that if I come to a point where I can't answer, it's the same point that your religion can't answer either. Because you're just making shit up. You haven't answered a single question up to this point. Everything we actually know and can show to be true, we know through science. Now, so this is why I always say that science doesn't know everything, but religion doesn't know anything. There's not one time that anybody can point to in the history of science where a supernatural explanation turned out to be right. Every time we ever ascribed anything to supernatural causes, and we have several times, we thought that lightning was, you know, God's punishing liars, we thought that comets were an omen, we thought that epilepsy was a demonic possession, we thought that diseases, simple diseases, were curses, until we came up with cell theory, right? And germ theory, and things of this sort. And every time we discovered what the real explanation is, every time, it not only turned out that the supernatural reason, that the religious example or explanation turned out to be wrong, but that the right answer was a revelation of whole new fields of study, previously unimagined and vastly more complex than the witchcraft or demonic possession or stupid ideas that we came up prior to that. And whenever we find, if we find, all of the explanations for the origin of life, or what was the catalyst to erupt the Big Bang, if we ever discover those answers, it again will be a new field of study, way more complex than anything we previously understood, and it will not, I suspect, not ever turn out to be a genie in a rope. I'm pretty sure of that one. The 15th foundational falsehood of creationism is the claim that evolution is just a theory, not a fact. And this one is particularly annoying to me because nobody knows what the hell the word means, and they use it wrong on purpose in many cases. But it means that I have to teach middle school biology to teachers, to people who should know better. In this case, I had to give a lesson to the chairman of the Board of Education in my state when she complained that she had 150 scientists giving their testimony to say that evolution, the theory of evolution, is better supported than the theory of gravity. And she couldn't understand that. Instead, she railed that she thought that the scientific conspiracy was trying to reduce the law of gravity to only a theory, in which case I had to show her what the collective laws, multiple laws of gravity are, and then had to say, well, that's Newtonian gravity. We're now into Einstein's relativity. Why? Because gravity turned out to be wrong. The theory of gravity is wrong. Think about that. Right? Why don't we teach that controversy? Of course, they wouldn't consider that. And of course, if you argue with religious people online, you're doubtless you're going to find that a lot of them use logical fallacies and so forth, and a lot of them will make allegations that they know can't be correct, and they don't care about your answers. This is all about make-believe. And when I was recording the audiobook with David Smalley at the Dogma Debate Studios, he challenged me or contested me on the first foundational falsehood of creationism. Now, as I said, we have a lot of scientists who hold superstitious beliefs and supernatural beliefs at the same time. And it seems that when I was a kid, everybody kind of did. I mean, maybe this is, raise your hands if this is what your experience is. When you were young, did it seem like everybody accepted science but also had a belief in some sort of supernatural thing, like a soul that we all die and continue on or something like that? I'm seeing a lot of heads nodding. But nowadays, it's not quite so much that way. We see that religion is in a state of decline, wholesale, across the board throughout the United States. There are individual denominations that claim that they are growing, but religion as a whole is in a dramatic decline, especially when you talk about college-age kids. And you don't have people adopting religion later on. You do have religious people surrendering religion later in life in large numbers. But no more than 3% of people who were not religious are adopting religion. That's just not happening. So the world is becoming more secular. You have people walking away from religion altogether, which is fine. But at the same time that religion is in decline, we have creationism, which is a form of religious extremism, on the rise. So how is it possible for both of these statistics to be at the same time? What's happening is those people who are still hanging on to religion are becoming more dogmatic about it and rejecting science outright. All science. Climate change, medical technology, all of it. They're all becoming Mike Pence. Where they're just denying science outright altogether. So they're becoming more extreme. And when you look at statistically the numbers, it's kind of scary because it's kind of down the middle. It's 46% to 52% of people that are walking away from religion and people that are walking away from science and becoming more religiously extreme. And so we're developing a very polarized nation. Now, as I said, a lot of scientific pioneers in evolutionary biology would hold supernatural beliefs and scientific understanding at the same time. They would say that because God can't be evidenced, and there's no way to test for God, there's no way to falsify the idea of God, that we can't disprove God, that science can't say anything about God. Now, as Smalley points out, there are some scientists, like Victor Stenger, for example, who say that something that science can say about God is that there is no support for that hypothesis. And even if you're talking to a scientist who is himself a believer, he should concede at least that. There is no actual evidence. That just what you can't explain doesn't mean that the explanation is magic. And of course, all these people say that they don't believe in magic, but the definition for miracles that they do believe in, and magic, are the same thing. They are the evocation of supernatural forces or entities to control or forecast natural events in ways which are inexplicable by science because they defy the laws of physics, meaning that they are physically impossible, and thus God is physically impossible by definition. And the only other rationale that I get for God is that God exists outside of our reality, which means he does not exist in reality, so why are we even having this conversation? Now, another thing that Victor Stenger said about God was that there's no value in that hypothesis. There is certainly no epistemological or scientific value in that hypothesis. Even if we could, indicate or falsify it. And that God is, he said it, God is a meaningless concept because he is undefined, which means literally it is meaningless. And that he's undetectable, unfalsifiable, and literally immaterial with no reason to believe it. And I would add quite a few good reasons not to. And someone criticized me recently saying that we can't say, as I often do, we can't say that there is no God because we don't really know. But don't we? When I got into a debate on the radio with Pastor Bob Enyer of Denver Bible Church, he started into that game of, you know, absence of evidence doesn't mean evidence of absence and so forth. And so I said, okay, fine, I can tell where he's headed with that. And I said, are there leprechauns? And he surprised me. He said, no. Just flat out, no. Like, he knows there's no leprechaun. How can you know that? Did you look everywhere? Have you been to the end of the rainbow? And he said that he knows that there are no leprechauns because there's no evidence of them. That's it. I said, thank you, we're done. You just conceded the argument. Right? If he can say that there are no leprechauns, I can say there is no God. For the same reason, because there is no evidence of it. Now, I could also go on and say that there, you know, leprechauns and fairies and all of those sorts of things are impossible for any number of other reasons. And I can do the same thing with God, too. It is physically and definitively impossible for a mind to exist independent of the brain that created it. And it is impossible for complex interdependent material systems to be spoken out of nothing, out of an incantation spell. These are not possible. There is no precedent or parallel to or verified phenomena to indicate that such is even a possibility. It is not a possibility. And a lot of people will say that anything is possible. I hate when they say that because it means it's possible that monkeys might fly out of my ass. No. No airborne simians are emerging from this colony. It is not possible for the cow to jump over the moon. You know, there are some things that are not possible. And they are literally arguing for magic. Now, beyond the dismissal of other absurdities, I can, unsupported absurdities, no, asserted without any verification or justification, I can also show positive indication that all of the gods of men are creatures of the id, formed of the imagination, of irrational conjuring. And I'd like to take this opportunity to address critics who said that I overstated my case when I said that the Bible is absolutely wrong about absolutely everything. I said this about creationists too, but again, we're only talking about the things that are relevant to this discussion. I accept that some of the people and places that the Bible mentions actually existed, but that doesn't lend any justification for their claims. Likewise, I would accept that creationists on occasion might discover that they are out of milk or butter, and unless they're vegans, they should buy some more. They can be right about that. But when we're talking about what they believe about evolution and the assertions that they make about creationism, all of these things are wrong. The Bible makes two different types of claims. All of the claims that the Bible makes falls into one of two categories. Not evidently true, and evidently not true. And there is a distinction between these two. There are unsupported impossibilities asserted with no reason at all that we can't disprove only because they're unfalsifiable, and there are unsupported impossibilities that can be disproved because we've already disproved them. And that's all that the Bible has. There's nothing that the Bible can be shown to be right about that has any significance other than the fact that some town existed or something like that, or that some king might have existed, and that's it. There's nothing to indicate any of the important claims that they make. There's no God, there's no devil, there's no heaven or hell. We have no afterlife because we have no soul. No one ever lived 3 days inside a fish. And no army of the undead was ever reanimated by Jehovah praying to the four winds to have it done. And Jesus never walked on water and may never have walked at all. Woman did not come from a man's rib. And man did not come from a golem spell. We know all of this for absolutely certain. What's a golem spell? Is that the question? Okay. A golem spell is that in the Jewish tradition, you have to remember that Jesus was originally Jewish, right? So in the Jewish tradition of old magic, you had, and this is really old magic, going back thousands of years, older than Christianity, there was this old spell, and you can find this in Enuma Elish, and even that's the oldest creation myth on record, is Enuma Elish. They make clay figurines and then breathe into them the breath of life, which they believe that breath, literally, air, is spirit. So all of our illusions of having a supernatural spirit living inside us is literally our breath. Ecclesiastes 3:18-21 talks about who knows whether the spirit of the breath goes down into, or the spirit of the animal, or breath of the animal, depending on which translation you read, goes down into the earth, or the spirit slash breath of man ascends upward. Who knows? Right? That's like the one piece of wisdom I could find in the whole Bible. But they would create this spell. They made clay figurines, breathe into them, and they become alive. And that's what God did with Adam. And that's what all of the old mages did with previous incarnations. Like that, one of the original stories in Enuma Elish that leads to Genesis 1, this is one of the contradictions with Genesis 2. You notice in Genesis 1 that they create men and women at the same time, a multiplicity of them, and then in Genesis 2 they create only one man, and then God forgets. He makes a pair, a breeding pair for everything else, and somehow forgot to make a breeding female for man. You know, this is what kind of infallible God we have. Oh yeah, that's what I forgot to create a female for you. So, the tree of knowledge of good and evil was never a literal tree. Everywhere in the Bible that it talks about the fruit of, it's talking about a parable. It's obviously a parable. It's where it's talking about the choices or the results of the choices that you make. The single exception being Genesis, where we're supposed to accept that, you know, the fruit of is somehow something different, that it's an actual tree that you could cut down and build a canoe out of it. But we know that's not the case, right? You can't gather forbidden fruit and make pie, although I would certainly try that. The story, imagine if the forbidden fruit was a literal thing that really existed, then wouldn't you have insects and birds and squirrels and stuff eating forbidden fruit and figuring out that they're naked? So this is a parable, this is a fable with a moral, but it has no connection to reality. We know none of this really happened. Now, experts on biblical history can't even be sure if David or Solomon even existed. Even that. Maybe not even Jesus. They can't even be sure about that. But we know that there was no Adam and Eve. That's certain. And we're pretty sure there was never a Moses either. They can't figure out where Moses was supposed to fit. They've looked at all of the pharaonic times of from 1250 BC down to 750 BC, and they can't, or 1750 BC, and can't figure out where he would fit, because he doesn't. And there's no point where the Exodus works at all. Remember, that was a sermon by Senior Rabbi David Wolpe, 2001, at the Sinai Temple in Los Angeles, where he said that with very few exceptions, every archaeologist in the world agrees that the way the Bible describes the Exodus is not the way it happened, if it happened at all. So this is a very blatant admission. What about Goliath the giant? Even if there was a David, would there have been a Goliath? Almost certainly not, right? The firmament, anybody know what a firmament is?
I think so.
Okay, the way that the earth...
The outer heavens and the inner part?
The way the Bible describes the earth is as a flat disk, right? It's like a map drawn out on a table, and it literally is a table. Because they've got it set. The map of the earth, the flat disk is set on columns, which is then suspended on nothing, placed in the bottom of an oceanic abyss. It's an infinite abyss of ocean. And then over the top of this disk, they put a crystal dome. It's transparent, but it's solid. And it's described that way in a number of places in the Bible, where there are windows within the firmament that let the water from the oceanic abyss in, and there's fountains underneath that let it up from the bottom. Right, so you have this snow globe is essentially what the world is. And this was a common belief in many different religions across Asia and the Orient at that time. Of course, it's still wrong, but there are precursors, pre-Judean belief systems that held to the same idea. Why would God reinforce this falsehood? Why wouldn't God describe it correctly? Right? We know the firmament isn't real. And I don't know what kind of excuse people come up with for how it's described this way and what it's talking about. But as I said, they have a requirement to believe it even if it doesn't make any sense, even when they know that it's wrong. A trumpet blowing down the walls of Jericho, did that happen? Anybody can believe that? How about the sun stopping in the sky? That proves again that we're talking about, you know, the, what was said about the firmament. Because inside the firmament, the sun and the moon are both supposed to be under the firmament. They're not out in space. They're inside that expanse, as they call it. Is it the expanse? Yeah, it is the expanse. The space inside the firmament. And the sun and the moon are both the same size. And they're both smaller, or they're both larger than the stars. And the stars are just tiny little things that fall to Earth and you can stomp on them. And in one case, three stars come down to Earth to do battle with one man. That's badass. So what about the other ones? Samson's magic hair? Well, I guess I can see that one. So somebody tells me that, you know, they found some town that the Bible talks about, and so that it proves that this town is real, and that proves that all of the ridiculous stories in the Bible are real, right? Except, I point out, well, they also found, archaeologists found, the city of Troy. Does that prove Zeus? Does that prove any of the gods of Hellenism? Of course not. You know, people made up their stories about the famous people and places that they knew about. They still do the same thing. I mean, in the third episode of the Raiders of the Lost Ark movies, and you have our hero going to Germany, and he literally bumps into Adolf Hitler. Despite what the Holocaust deniers say, we know that Germany is real, and we know that Hitler really existed. But that doesn't mean that Indiana Jones did. And it doesn't mean that the Ark of the Covenant existed either. And one thing that you'll get probably only from me, this is my pet hypothesis, I don't know that anybody else is promoting this idea, but there is a kernel of truth, as I see it, to the Tower of Babel, to the story of the Tower of Babel, one of the most ridiculous tales in the Bible. The kernel of truth is this. The tower actually exists. It's still there. The foundations were begun by Hammurabi around 1750 BCE, and construction was supposed to have been continued by Nebuchadnezzar, but again, he failed later on. The Mesopotamian Empire collapsed, and the project was never completed. But in Hammurabi's time, when he begun this project, the Mesopotamian Empire was the most advanced society in the world. They had invented syllabic text. They had the most developed form of writing. They had formal schools teaching classrooms of students how to read and write in cuneiform. And this is a form of writing where you press letters of a sort into clay tablets, and it would be baked into permanent documents. But when the tower, or when the Mesopotamian Empire collapsed, obviously the schools closed. And within a generation or so, no one could read or write in cuneiform anymore. So all of these tens of thousands of documents from all of these ancient stories from 2500 and 3000 BC are now kept alive by oral tradition because nobody can make sense of the old writings. That's the only truth of it, you know, where you can't understand each other according to the story is that God came down from the clouds to see what people were doing because he's not really omniscient. And he has to ask questions, like where he has to ask Satan where he's coming from. And when he has to argue with Abraham, well, how many people are there? I don't know, because I haven't been there. I haven't sent my angels to know, because God doesn't know everything. So he has to come down through the clouds and look at the tower and say, oh, you're trying to climb up to me. Well, I'll end that. Earlier this year, I was in the Burj Khalifa. I was in the observation deck. So I'm 148 stories high in the world's tallest freestanding structure. God was not up there. And he was not pissed off that they had built this ridiculously tall building. If you've ever seen it, the Burj Khalifa is this horrible structure that it dwarfs all of the skyscrapers around it. It's absurdly big. But getting back to this, these ancient stories, and we know that there were many, because we found Asher Bernapul's library, 22,000 ancient tablets found in his library that people had to figure out the language in order to be able to learn how to read them. Eventually they did. When they did figure out how to read in cuneiform, they started realizing that there's some perilous similarities here. We have the story of Enki wandering the sacred garden, which was then being guarded by, it was the Garden of Inanna, and it was then being guarded by Ninhursag. And Ninhursag finds Enki wandering around eating all of the forbidden fruits, because all of the fruits in the garden are forbidden. And when she catches him doing this, she cursed him, and he fell. Now that sounds familiar, right? We have a fallen immortal, fallen from eating forbidden fruit. And then she feels sorry about it later, so she gives birth to seven daughters, which are meant to cure his wounds. Now this is obviously, we're talking about myths, we're talking about parables, right? But one of these daughters, Ninti, was the daughter born of the rib for she was born to close the wound to his side. And I'm thinking, where have I read almost exactly this verbiage before? So we see that what has happened is these people keep these stories alive by oral tradition for 1,000 years until the Phoenicians eventually wrote it down 1,000 years later, right? So the stories have obviously evolved. They've been adapted, they've been embellished, they've been exaggerated, they've incorporated new deities. So the Tower of Babylon eventually is abbreviated to the Tower of Babylon. What was originally dedicated to the god Marduk has now been reappropriated to another god who's been promoted from the Canaanite pantheon in a pre-Judean period. So we know that one of the stories that was adapted is the story of Noah. You know, this is one of the things that we know for certain never happened, the global flood. And we have flood legends all over the world, but they're different, and they're different in important ways. In one story, that we have only a man and a woman surviving with no other animals. They survive by hiding in a giant seashell. In another story, all of the people and animals turn into fish and then turn back into their original forms after the flood is over with. And in the Greek version, which gets close to the reality, we have people that survive the flood by going into hilltops. Now, the creationist organizations don't tell you about these other types. They only want to focus on the similarities. But the similarities they're talking about are all focused in one area, the Iraqi floodplain, which is actually called an Iraqi floodplain for a reason. There's a number of inundations that they found for different periods, you know, happening in different places at different times, you know, like the Black Sea 7,000 years ago, and the Sea of Galilee 15,000 years ago. There's different floods like this that we know about, but there's one that was confirmed by archaeologists and geologists who have been centered on the city of Shurippak around 2900 BCE. And this one appears to be the source of the legends that were later attributed to Atrahasis, Ubartutu, Utnapishtim, Siasudra, and eventually Noah after sufficient exaggerations. One of the interesting details that the archaeologists and geologists confirmed was the depth of the flood. Roughly 22 feet or 15 cubits. And that may be 7 meters, but I don't know if I can find a cubits to meters conversion ratio online. Nobody can figure out what a cubit is, precisely. But roughly that amount. Now what makes this significant is that it kind of lends justification to all of these other related stories where all of these other details match to, like the sacrifice on the mount and the sending out the bird to find the land and all of this. All of that makes sense if you look at the older versions, older than the Bible. No, a lot of people think the Bible is the oldest book there ever was, but clearly it is not. All of these other myths predate it by at least a millennia, if not more. And matter of fact, the Epic of Gilgamesh is much older than the written versions of it. So it's already been exaggerated before it was written down the first time. But hold on, I'm skipping across something. Be right with you. All right. So one of the things that I want to talk about Potholer 54. If you've ever seen him, he's another YouTuber like myself. He makes really good videos on creationism and so forth. And he made a video about how Answers in Genesis was talking about the flood. They want to preserve this belief in the flood. And they promote the idea that the flood happened around 2188 BCE. And they're talking about how you can get from 8 people that they say survived that flood to 7 billion people today. And they came up with a calculation that they could double the population every 150 years, taking into account floods, famines, pestilence, and all those sorts of things, and ignoring everything we know about population growth over time, because that's scientific data, and who cares about that? But what that would mean, that if Answers in Genesis is correct, which they've never been before, but if they were correct, then that would mean that if the entire global population had collaborated to build the world's first, or Egypt's first pyramid, because there's actually older pyramids than what are in Egypt, but if the entire world population collaborated on the first of the Egyptian pyramids, they couldn't have built it because there were only 40 people alive in the world at that time. So what Answers in Genesis did was that they realized that they had to have a society of at least 30,000 people in order to provide the necessary infrastructure for a project of that magnitude. So how do you go from 8 people in 2188 BC to 30,000 people 150 years later? Well, they came up with another article that said that the population growth was actually 10 times as fast as they said before, without making reference to what they said before. They don't want people to read both articles because they don't want people to understand that they're talking both sides of their mouth, right? Giving two different contrived figures. So what they said is that one man and his one wife showed up in Egypt shortly after this flood, and that they had 8 children. Now, one man with one wife is a rarity in the Bible, but this is supposed to be immediately after a global extinction event. And the Bible doesn't say that this particular character had 8 children. It only says that he had 4 sons. But of course, the Bible's a grossly sexist tome in which women were never important enough to be, or rarely important enough to be named, and daughters often aren't mentioned at all. We all accept that Adam and Eve must certainly have had daughters, right? But of course, nobody ever mentions those. So these apologists just assume, for no reason at all, because this is what apologists do, that there were also 4 daughters, and that each of the sons married his sister, and that they had each had 8 children themselves per incestuous couple over generations of about 30 years at a time, with subsequent sons sleeping with their sisters and continuing the same pattern for 150 years, and they could generate in that time 30,000 people despite all the inbreeding, which, of course, by then would be so genetically disadvantaged that they would be the sorts of people who would believe the works of Answers in Genesis. Now, they got all of their dates wrong. You know, they said 2188 BC was the date of the flood. We now know that the flood that they're talking about, which was not on the scale that they're talking about, which was not even dedicated to their god at all, that the flood that they're actually talking about was originally dedicated to a collection of gods, and the flood got out of their control. And the reason that they created the flood was because people got too noisy. But the flood they're talking about happened in 2900 BC, which actually gives them more time than they thought. But they got the date for the pyramid wrong, too. That's 2630 BC, not the time that they said. And they also were dependent on the Tower of Babel, which they don't understand what the Tower of Babel is. And they've got all of their myths out of order for their calculation. Another problem that they have calculating populations is the story of the Exodus, and I think this is another one that you'll probably only get from me. There's not anybody else I know of that's proposing this one. There's a time in the Bible where you're supposed to have 2 million Hebrew slaves in one town in Egypt at a time when the entire Egyptian population was only 3.5 million. Now, if you can include these Hebrews, they outnumber the entire natural national population living all in one town. How were they slaves? How do they not own the place already? Because whenever they cut loose, they cut down everyone around them. According to the Bible, these desert brigands killed millions of people once they got their freedom. Hundreds of thousands at a time. More than Answers in Genesis can even admit were alive by then. And Answers in Genesis hasn't come up with a third bullshit article to try to come up with how there were all these other people available to kill. But if we ignore for the moment all of the Hebrew women and children, and only talk about the 600,000 men on foot that were supposed to be living in Ramses, that the Bible talks about, and they want to go to Canaan, this is their promised land, what if, my proposal, they start marching for Canaan, the promised land, following the coastline, following the Red Sea, following the Mediterranean coastline, and they walk for 20 miles a day, which would be typical for that time. It would take them 2 weeks. It would take them a fortnight to get to their promised land. And the first ones would get there if they were marching single file, with one man, 1 leader, ahead of the next man. The first ones would get there before the last ones left. The line of single file marching men would be that long, because it's only 450 kilometers or 280 miles. And it's hard to get lost when you're following the coastline. But the Bible says that with God's help, a 2-week trek turned into 40 years of wandering lost in the desert. How's that for divine guidance? And this 40-year period of the blind leading the blind happened at a time when most people didn't live that long, so that nobody who started the trip was alive by the end. The children who were born along the way were the only ones that had a chance of getting out again. So none of the numbers match up, and creationists know that it doesn't. But they don't care, because this isn't an attempt to understand anything. This is all about pretend. This is literally make-believe. Deceivers seek believers because they need patsies to pay the tithe and to reinforce their preferred delusions. They want to believe what they want to believe, and they don't care if it's true. So their faith is so willfully obtuse that it is actually matches the description that psychiatrists give for psychotic delusion. If you look up the National Alliance on Mental Illness, it'll explain to you that a delusion is a fixed false belief that will not change despite evidence to the contrary, to assert something is true when there is evidence against it. And they also give the definition of a delusion, or excuse me, of psychosis, as being a detachment from reality, which delusion is again. But in both cases, there is the caveat, except when it is a person's cultural group belief system. In other words, it's only okay when religion does it. So, regarding creationism, I mean, we know that how religion is reinforcing a delusion, but creationism is a form of religious extremism because it denies reality, being that it is all about pretend, and they will reject science willfully. There are people who believe in creation for honest reasons. There are honest people who believe in creationism because everyone around them believes the same thing. They think there must be some credence to it. Maybe they don't understand it. But when they get into arguments with people who do know, and I'm sure many of you, if you've gotten online and had these discussions, you've probably witnessed this happen for yourself. When they encounter somebody who actually knows what they're talking about, this will be the first time that they've seen their beliefs really challenged. And then they find themselves very quickly having to make a choice, whether they're going to remain honest or whether they're going to remain creationist, because it is no longer possible to be both. Now, in my book, I cover a lot of the science specific to this to make it easier for people to understand. They haven't done a lot of research on this. They haven't wasted as much of their lives pursuing this as I have. And I don't think anybody else has written a book like this. It also talks about the hypocrisy and the blatant, willful dishonesty, as well as the absurdities, atrocities, contradictions, and inconsistencies in the Bible. And these include prophecies that are often claimed as proof of the Bible, but which have actually failed rather spectacularly if you look up what the prophecy really says and then what really happened. Now, the purpose of my book is to offer a biological and theological reference explaining how to refute the fundamentalist favorite fallacies against the sanity of science and secularism. And that is my presentation. I'm open to Q&A if you like, but I'm done with this. Thank you very much.
We'll pass along the infamous bicycle hat that got us thrown out of the library. So it's indeed blamed
on me.
And then we can go into our Q&A and just discussion. Go ahead. Anybody has any ideas?
Yes. If anybody has a question, I'm here.
Yeah, I got a question about this term intelligent design that they seem to shift from creationism to this other term. You didn't even mention intelligent design. I was wondering what you think about that, or is that just a ploy, another ploy, or?
Yeah, intelligent design is a deliberate scam. And it is a ploy. It is creationism, and they've proven that in the court of law. Of course, the creationists will never admit this. They want to present this as if this was something different. I was actually on a TV show in Dallas where they had, I wasn't on the show, it was in the studio audience. But what they had was they set up three people on the stage because they wanted to create this illusion, right? They had somebody who's an open creationist, typical standard young earth creationist, and then they had on the other side, they had an evolutionary biologist who was an atheist. And then they had someone sitting in the middle who doesn't identify as a creationist, but identifies as an intelligent design theorist. Now, he is a creationist in every sense, but they want to create the illusion that there's some middle ground here, like you have a reasonable option, right, to creationism. But what they found was in the Kitzmiller versus Dover trial, a friend of mine, Barbara Forrest, found when she was going through the textbook that they were trying to promote called Pandas and People, and she found that it had been written before 1987. It was originally written before 1987, where there was an important Supreme Court case, Edwards versus Aguilar, where they said that it was unconstitutional to teach creationism in public school because it is just a religion. It has no scientific purpose. This was the ruling. So she noticed that there was a difference between the pre-1987 textbook and the post-1987 textbook, and that was the important difference was two macro commands only. That was the definition of creationism. The word creationism was changed to intelligent design so that the definition remained exactly the same. Right? So even if it hadn't been intentionally deceptive, the very fact that the definition remains exactly the same still belies the problem. The only other macro change was when they changed the word creationists to design proponents. That's the only two changes made in the entire textbook. And they did it immediately after the Supreme Court ruled. So they willfully disguised their intent. And the judge, in that case, John E. Jones III, in his ruling, he lamented how so many people would so proudly tout their religious convictions in public, and yet, time and again, lie to cover their real agenda of the ID policy. So when they changed creationists to design proponents, there was a misspelling in the book that screwed up the macro command. So that at one point the book said, see design proponentsists. Yeah, and this became the buzzword showing how intelligent design is deliberately deceptive. They're trying to evade the law, to do something they know to be illegal, which is also obviously unethical. And this while they're pretending to be oh so moral. Were there any other questions? Yes.
Just 12 years ago when I was a high school sophomore in my first real biology class, because I haven't been in middle school, even in this is secular area, my teacher still, I distinctly remember this, because it was before, because it was never terribly religious, but at the time I would have described that I did believe in God to some extent. But for some reason this stuck with me, that even here, he still paused to briefly discuss how, before he started even talking about evolution, how it was a touchy subject, and this is something you need to be very careful about, the way he worded things. And even then, I still had the thought, what are you doing? Why are you doing this? Just teach what the material is. And I could not understand why just teaching what you're supposed to be teaching was so...
This is another reason that my wife and I do the classroom supplement series that we do. We know that there are teachers who are no good at teaching evolution even if they wanted to. Right? We know that there are teachers who will not teach it correctly. A good example is my son's biology class, where they have textbooks and the teachers don't always teach from the textbooks. So the teacher's telling the class that there's never been a beneficial mutation. I'm required to teach you evolution, but I'll tell you now, there's never been a beneficial mutation. My son points out in the textbook, but the teacher, the textbook says, or the textbook lists beneficial mutations. And he was sent to the office for insubordination. I wanted to make that teacher famous, but my son's mother refused to let me. She wouldn't let me touch, while my son is still in school. Right? Of course, by the time he's out, the teacher's out too. I've had a number of other missed opportunities like that. But one of the reasons that we do the classroom supplement series, we know that there are people who homeschool their kids because they know that if you say take your kids to public school, they're not going to learn evolution because the teachers won't teach it, even if they're legally required to do so. I've seen creationists make an attempt to teach evolution, but they jack it up so much that it's worse than if they didn't try to teach it at all. And I've seen where teachers are competent, they understand the science, they're even good at what they do, and they still can't teach it because we have students in Texas, and I'm sure elsewhere, that are trained by their church congregations to react to certain buzzwords, to disrupt the class with idiocy, with stupid challenges that just prevent everybody else from learning anything. And then if you can get past the students, even if they could deal with the hecklers in the classroom, then you've got the complaints from the parents. If you can get past that, then you find out that your administrators are no longer supportive. So if it's found out that you are a non-believer and you're teaching evolution, you will be fired, and we've seen that happen a number of times. So we come up with these classroom lessons that homeschoolers can use as well, and that teachers who are uncertain about how to teach it or whether they even accept it themselves, they don't have to. Many teachers are so far behind the curve, they don't even know what the subject is that they're teaching until the week before, when they're just brushing up on it themselves. And when you're in a place that already has 20% of our teachers are creationists to begin with, we don't get good statistics on people being able to teach it. So if we can just get people to take our video, play it in their class, it's 10-minute classroom supplement videos, and it's based on the national standards of what they're supposed to be tested for, then they can step away from all responsibility, right? These are according to the national standards. This is what you're supposed to be taught. Here's a lesson that's approved by, you know, Board of Education or whatever. Certainly not our Board of Education, but approved by national standards. This is what you're supposed to be taught. They can put that in, and they just have to walk away from all responsibility for it. The students get an accurate lesson, because all of that has been peer reviewed, right? They get an accurate lesson, and the teacher isn't held responsible for it. And if the teacher is competent or not, it doesn't matter. It's still the same lesson that we've reviewed to make sure that it's all accurate. And that's one of the reasons we do what we do. I hope that addressed it.
Yeah. I did have an actual follow-up question on that.
What's that?
Because this is something I've been following you ever since I first discovered your Foundational Falsehoods of Creationism, and that I've never heard you talk all that much about me. It's just because it's a lot of other people do talk about it. But particularly here in the Bay Area, as secular as we are, the word atheist is still something that comes with a kind of a cringe factor to it. And it's that trying to keep organizations like the East Bay Atheists, I think that one of the difficulties is not so much that there's still so much religiosity, but just because there's so many people who don't like either side of it. And I'm curious to know what you think about people who don't want to enter into this and how that affects them.
Well, I'm part of the Atheist Out program. I do everything I can to get people to admit that they are atheists and to report that way. There was a Pew Research poll that was recently done that said that only 3.1% of Americans identified as atheists. 4% identified as agnostic, regardless of the fact that they are also atheists. And I know agnostics say that that means that they don't know, right? Well, they don't know that they're atheists. Because atheist means that you don't believe there's a God. If you don't know that there's a God, you don't believe there is either, right? I've had one of my oldest and dearest friends criticized another of my friends, saying, well, you can't be an atheist because you don't know for absolutely certain that there's no God. But that's not a requirement. Are you convinced that an actual deity really exists? I asked my friend. He says, well, no. And I said, well, then, welcome to the club. You're an atheist. Shut up. And he says, well, I'm not convinced there is a God, but I'm not convinced there's not one either. I said, it doesn't matter. You're still an atheist. There is no middle point. You're either convinced, you're not convinced, not convinced, not convinced until you are convinced. There's not a middle point. Right? You can pretend all you want to, but if you're not convinced, if you haven't crossed that line, then you're atheist. And that's the way that I would like to see polls respond. Because if you look at the way that the rest of the people reported, another 15.8% said that they were not religious. That's how they identify. They did not identify as atheist or agnostic. They said they're non-religious. And they said that religion isn't important. That's atheist.
Yeah.
They are without theism, right? That's what atheism means. And another 1.1% said that they also live without religion, but the religion is important. But obviously it's not important to them, it's important to other people. So when you add all of those up, that's 24% of America is atheist. We outnumber Catholics. So why the hell do we not have anybody pandering for our vote? It's because of all the people who think that atheist is somebody who knows there is no God or for whatever reason refuses to use a word. So me and a number of other atheist organizations, I'm president of Atheist Alliance of America, and we are talking with American atheists and probably also the Secular Coalition of Reason, but they haven't, or so Secular Coalition for America, I can't remember. They haven't said yes yet anyway, so it doesn't really matter. We're hoping that they will. But we want to collaborate to raise the money to get Gallup to do that poll where we ask. We've noticed that if you ask people, do you believe in God, everybody says yes. But you say, are you convinced there's a God, everybody says no. It's the same question. And then if you say God, then people think, you know, God is love or God is nature. No, an actual deity, right? Are you convinced an actual deity really exists? I suspect that we will find out that there's more than just a quarter of the country. I suspect we'll find out that there's at least a third of the country, because I've met a lot of Christians and Jews and Hindus who say that who identify by their religious tradition, even though they admit that they don't believe in their scriptures and they don't believe in any God. But that makes you atheist, not Methodist. And I say that because I actually know of an atheist, he doesn't identify as an atheist, he calls himself a non-theist Methodist Christian minister. How the fuck does that work? So you have to get past the labels and ask a poll that does that. And then I think we'll see that a third of the country is actually non-believers, and it's important that we see that. It's 30%, not 3%. And I understand why people don't want to identify as atheists, because there's a slight difference between calling yourself an atheist and calling yourself a humanist. More people know what an atheist is than know what a humanist is, which is sad that so few people, even that most atheists don't know they're atheists, right? They call themselves agnostics, right? I called myself an agnostic pagan for Christ for a long time before I figured out what any of those words meant. Mm-hmm. But the other difference between calling yourself an atheist from calling yourself a humanist or calling yourself a, you know, some other, you know, non-religious or spiritual but not religious, whatever bullshit they come up with, is that a lot of atheists are assholes. Yeah, and we have not been a cohesive movement. It's often been said that getting atheists to rally around any idea is like herding cats, right? And we tend to fight with each other more than we do with our common enemy. And we can't seem to realize that we have a common cause because we would rather do infighting. This is a very disturbing thing for me. Right? I mean, there are so many different types of division that people will come up with for, you know, political, social, whatever. Like one of the things that I was getting very often is if I believe that government has a reason to exist, if the government has any job to do, well, then I'm accused of being a state theist. Right? Because there's so many, because atheists aren't all liberals. We have libertarians, we have right-wingers too. And anytime that they find a difference, right, it doesn't matter that we share anything in common. That a lot of people will only look for whatever differences we have and use those to divide us. And this is one of the things that I'm working against. I always say, when I get on stage with any other prominent atheist, that I don't agree with anybody about everything, nor do we have to. You know, I mean, I've been with P.C. Myers or with Penn Jillette. I don't agree with either of them on very much, but I will use either of them, whatever they want to contribute to my cause, as best I can. I hope that addresses what you're saying. Yes, sir.
I'm familiar with the Secular Coalition of America, and sort of, I feel like I've sort of watched from afar that thing form and have whatever internal problems they had not too long ago. What's your organization? I'm not familiar with yours, the Atheist Alliance, and how does it compare to theirs?
Well, I don't know about previous incarnations, because Atheist Alliance of America has gone through a lot of significant changes very, very recently, and I'm part of those changes. One of the things that I liked about the earlier version of Atheist Alliance of America was the way that they build communities, right? And so we do the Secular World magazine, and we give out the Dawkins Award, which we're going to continue to do. But the thing that I want to work on most as president of that organization is establishing a network, an alliance of atheists. Booking this tour, for example, I had a hell of a time looking up atheists in getting given area, and then establishing a communication, getting somebody that would actually answer an email address. So I mean, I spent like 2 or 3 months just sending out to various emails until I could get somebody to respond to something and get me connected to whatever groups you have in that area. Shouldn't be like that. At the same time, I'm getting emails from other people that have just moved in from Santiago, Chile or whatever. I'm 88 years old and I've just moved to this area, and where are the atheists here? So I now have to refer them to where are the atheist groups. Why don't we have a website that links all of the atheist groups, not just atheists, but the humanist groups, the skeptics groups, whatever, you know, primary identification they want, and also list their events, not just their local social events, but their conferences and conventions and international events as well. You know, this is the kind of thing that I want to set up. Because my goal here is that I understand that we all have social needs, right? And this is why so many of us attend things like, I myself attend something called the Fellowship of Freethought. It's one of the Dallas-Fort Worth Coalition of Reason. It's like two dozen atheist secular groups that gather together for social purposes. But we have more than that. We have common goals. We have a common enemy. And while we may not agree on much, the majority of us do want not to be represented by people like Pence, for example. We don't want our current governor and lieutenant governor in the state of Texas mandating their extreme religious views on our kids in school. You know, there are some things we share in common that we would actually fight against. And this is what I would like to do. If there's any way to do it, anything collectively, you know, I want to establish a change in American society with regard to the label of atheist and what that means to people and how we are treated. And I'm tired of being more hated than Muslims. Not that I want Muslims to be more hated than anybody else. I don't mind being the minority demographic. I just want it to be justified. You know, what, do I want that to be justified? No, scratch that. I want to improve our image, and I want to improve our communications, and I want to improve society as best I can. Unfortunately, that's wanting to advocate for people's rights and try to improve our situation is also classified under the definition of social justice, and there's a lot of people that react violently just at that word. So we tend to be working against ourselves and against our common goals too much. Any other? Yes, back there.
What was your website again where you can purchase these videos?
The video, they're not for purchase. I upload them on two channels. I have my regular channel, Aronra, but I also upload the educational videos, the classroom supplement videos, go to a separate channel dedicated just to that topic that is not expressly about atheism. That's called the Living Science videos. And you'll know that you got the right one when you got a picture of an emu, an emu's face. The most famous picture of an emu that was ever taken is this one where an emu gets right up in the camera, face on. Yeah. If you look up emu online, you get this ridiculous face getting right in the camera. That's my bird. I had this bird living in my backyard for like 3 years, and I would walk him down to the park, and somebody came up to take a picture of him one day. I recognized the pond and everything in the background. That's my bird.
Huh.
I just think that's cool.
Yeah.
It is cool.
Love that bird. And it's weird when you walk down the street with a 2 meter tall bird walking next to you. Yes, sir.
Thanks for coming. I appreciate it. It's nice to meet you, actually, or to see you in person, and not just on YouTube videos. Two quick things. One is I'm thinking of the seculardirectory.org, which is a site that you put in your zip code and it does list atheist and free thinker groups. It's a pretty broad net based on zip code. And I was just checking it out because I thought, I think there's the seculardirectory.org. And it lists right here, it lists about 20 different groups within 30 miles of San Jose, including this group. So there's that asset might be something to check out.
Well, I'd like to get it included in the network.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah.
Yeah, so that's a good resource, seculardirectory.org, I think is what it was called. But my second point is more a substantive question. So you might have noticed that a lady named Rosalyn Littman died recently, in fact, on Tuesday. She was a lawyer with the ACLU, and in 1989, she won a case, a Supreme Court case, that got the statement, "Glory to God in the highest, agree to be religious." It took a Supreme Court case to get that statement acquiesced to be a religious statement, and it was banned in that particular case. So it seems like we make real progress very slowly, but through the courts. As much as, I mean, you listed, they're willing to lie up and down, left, right, in and out, all day long. They'll lie for Jesus till the day they die, right? But the court forces some of this crap to stop. So what is your sense of that? Is that true? Is legal activity really a fundamental way for us to make very incremental progress, and sometimes we lose ground? But do you think that's a major, you know, avenue?
Well, for the most part, the Supreme Court has worked to our advantage. It's unfortunate that we know how science works, and science will not address creationism because science knows how science works. They have all the facts. They have all the data. Creationism has nothing. They know that, but they don't realize that they're not fighting against scientists, that they're not even fighting against sincere people, that they're fighting against lawyers who are going to use legislation against them. And it's not true what you said about how we always have these, I don't remember exactly how you phrased it, but the victories that we have that stop this crap, because it doesn't stop this crap. Since Edwards versus Aguilar in 1987, there have been a number of loopholes that have been exploited by different Christian organizations, so that right now, currently, there are thousands of public high schools teaching full-on creationism, apparently legally, by various means. One of them being, unless you're in Tennessee or Louisiana, where they can teach creationism legally anyway by some other loophole, I don't know what the legislative excuse is, but in a number of others, they teach the Bible as literature or as comparative religion or something along those lines, but what they end up actually doing is just teaching the Bible as if it were history. And all of these lessons, there was an expose a couple of years ago that showed that these lessons include anti-Semitism, denigration of other religions, rejection of science, and of course endorsing right-wing political ideologies, which is really what that's all about, because they want to manipulate the vote. Right? They want a working class that knows just enough to continue, George Carlin said, you know, they want a working class that just knows just enough to push the right buttons and doesn't ask questions, right? This is the society that they want. Sadly, that looks like they're getting it. We do have to fight in the courts because they won't fight in science because they know they can't. And it's all very disingenuous. And what that ultimately means is that while most people don't have the time or passion for this kind of bullshit going on in their lives, you have to have people that have spent way too much of their own time fighting this shit so that we have bulldogs. And I often say that there are better speakers than me. There are people with much better, much more scholarship than I have, but that for whatever other reason don't have the time, interest, or ability to confront these people in this kind of a head-on fashion. So you need bulldogs to clear the way for those other speakers. And as I said, I'm trying to raise public awareness on what the value of atheism is, what the value of secular thinking is, and just the very idea that faith is not a virtue. That faith is the most dishonest position it is possible to have, and to get people to understand that. And I make that challenge openly. You know, a lot of other people wouldn't say brash things like that because they think they're indefensible, but I've been there and I've seen how to defend it and I can do that. So one of the things that one of the editors of my book said that he was surprised that the publishing company let me get away with naming people when I tell specifically what they lied about. They said, you can say a lot of different things about people, but when you get very specific, then you have something where they might be able to sue you if you can't prove that you're right. But I can prove that I'm right. And I need a lot of people in this. So, yeah, I hope that addressed your question. Yes?
Can I get an idea from the audience, perhaps, because they're Californians, like locally, Berkeley schools? is creationism a problem in local schools in terms of teachers having to sort of give it lip service, et cetera? Any thoughts?
I'd have to say no.
I haven't heard anything.
We used to have a teacher who attended this group for a few years, young woman, and she would talk about, as an atheist, how careful she had to be, because if she specifically, for example, brought in an atheist perspective when she was bringing in other religious perspectives to address an issue, speakers, spokespeople, that could get the fundamentalists on her. And, you know, as a teacher, if you get a fundamentalist on you, it's sort of like, you know, some horrible creature that won't let go.
Right.
And they fight like crazy, and administrators don't like it. So those were the kinds of problems she had. She had to be careful what she would say, because the minority, the very vocal minority of fundamentalist Christians in this area, in the public schools, and as parents, can be very powerful, which of course is a lesson about how other people can also be powerful if they...
If I can tack on to that.
Yeah,
the atheist movement has powerful allies. They are, for example, in Texas, they passed this thing called the Merry Christmas Bill. And I know that my beloved governor, Rick Perry, was addressing me specifically when he signed it, because I was the only one that they got on record in public newspapers saying that you can't have a freedom from religion without having, you can't have freedom of religion without having freedom from religion, that you can't have religion enforced on you, that if you're a non-believer, there's all these different reasons why you wouldn't want to, in Texas, admit that you're a non-believer. You shouldn't have to be forced into this position. And the Merry Christmas Bill kind of does that, because it allows teachers to express their religious beliefs during the holiday season. Now, the backfire of that came from one of our allies, because he passed that bill and he said on camera, he looked into the camera and said, you know, freedom of religion is not freedom from religion. I'm like, well, yeah, thank you, asshole. But the backlash of that was that now you have teachers that are able to express their religious beliefs in the schools according to the provisions provided by the Merry Christmas Bill, which the Satanic Temple is now taking advantage of. So they can bring in the Satanic Christmas alternative, right? And they now have to respect that according to state law, right? So they're trying to figure out, well, how can we get away with this? If only we knew of some provision that would just stop all religious institutionalizing in the class. If only there was some amendment, maybe, that would do this. So yeah, another thing that they tried to do in Texas, which they wanted to provide not to have Sharia law. They want to protect against Sharia law. And again, they couldn't figure out that there's a First Amendment. So they wanted to write one law that would stop Sharia from getting a foothold, but also have other laws that would promote Christianity as the state religion. Just not getting it at all. And as I said, nobody wants to listen to just regular atheists because they're just what, you know, computer nerds. Everybody knows we really don't eat babies, right? Most of us. But then we get to Satanists. Now everybody's listening. And sadly, they hate atheists even more than they hate Satanists, because at least some Satanists play their game and even give them the moral high ground. The atheists are just pissing everybody off because we're telling them it is a game and you're all pretending. Yes, sir.
I listened to what you said about the need for groups to come together and there sort of be a focus, at least beginning in a local region and going up from there. About 6 years ago, it occurred to me that we needed a meetup site for atheists and skeptics and free thinkers and everything else, even agnostics. There was a meetup group that had 300 people in it, and once a month, six of them would take a short hike over in San Francisco, and that was the meetup. That was all they did. So at one point, the woman wanted to step down. I took it over, and somehow, after working at it, I've managed to get all these different groups to post to the meetup group. And the only rules I lay down are, if a group has an established meeting date for their primary meeting, you don't step on that meeting date by having your meeting date at the same date. Other than that, it's all open. I just let it happen. And actually, they owe me for 3 years worth of meetup fees right now because I haven't collected any money for a while. But you know, it works. And the hardest group to bring in were the skeptics. Because they just, you know, Gene Scott. Gene Scott. In terms of posting, there's a skeptic meeting that meets once a month about two blocks away in Pena. And I suggested, why don't you folks post your meetings on our meetup group? Committee for Inquiry is already sort of paying, a fee, and they don't really post much, so you could just post your skeptic group as, your meetings as part of that. She didn't even really listen to what I said. She read it as, we're going to have to post the atheist stuff in our groups. I said, no, I just want you to post your stuff in this meetup group that even includes skeptics in the meetup group. Now, finally, even they are posting their meetings. It's been going on. That was 6 months ago, and it's working. So, you can bring these people together. You can't get them to give up on their perspectives, but it is possible to bring them together and let them cooperate so that somebody who's sort of new to the whole experience can go to Meetup and type in atheist or skeptic or anything else and find this Meetup group, which now has 2,400 people in it.
They're very open about freedom of religion until they realize that that means freedom of other people's religion.
Yeah.
Right, were there any other questions? Yes?
I just want to mention, I think Meetup is sort of taking over what you were talking about earlier. Why can't we all get together on one website that would list all the, meeting places and everything? I think that's Meetup now. Because I remember a few years ago, do you remember UCOR? United Coalition of Reason? Does that ring a bell for anybody?
CORE, yeah.
Sadly, yes.
Okay. That was his whole idea a few years ago. He came, who was the guy?
Fred Edwards. They're still around. Jason Heap. Hassle me for a while when he took over.
That was the same idea. You just want to get everybody on one website, listing all the meetings. And
I was elected the head of the Coalition of Reason in the Bay Area. But then there were some problems, and it's like, the best thing that I thought to resolve the whole thing was just having the meetup.
So we've just got to work out how it is that we can be more unified, that we can fill up stadium-sized churches or church-like events twice a week, every week, still rake in tens of millions of dollars for all of our leading evangelicalizers or whatever you call them, and get away with all kinds of moral depravity and rule the government and have everybody treat us like we're knowledgeable and moral when we're really just bastardizing their children. Wouldn't it be great if we could just get away with everything and not be charged tax for it? The hell are they doing that we're not?
Theater. More theater.
Yeah. I don't know what it is, but it does seem to me. I mean, I've seen a lot of people that admit that they don't care what the truth is. They just want to believe what they want to believe, and they're all about that pretend thing. And I don't know what to sell them, what to offer them that has more appeal to them, because I mean, it just seems to be natural, seems to be innate. Whether you care to understand or do you just need to believe? I want to understand.
You've been talking to my mom.
There's a billboard in San Francisco I noticed recently that was something like, "You will." Like atheists will know the truth when they die or something, and so and there's not much of that in the Bay Area, but there's one up there, and then part of the thing is like, wow, really, I mean, so all their truth claims are only verified after death, you know, and along the way they want 10% of your money, but they won't give you any evidence until after you die.
Yeah, where it would be nice to see a billboard.
That's where we're missing out, is we need to have all these truth claims that only exist, you know, that can be verified in the internet.
Or we have the stick and the carrot, where we have the impossible reward that we don't ever have to actually have to pay off,
mm-hmm.
and then we have the threat of the fate worse than death if you don't buy our bullshit.
Yes.
That's a wonderful sales ploy. Mm-hmm. I'd like to see a billboard that says that the Christians still won't know the truth even after they're dead.
But they'll be dead.
It's like atheists revolves around a negative concept, revolves around an absence of a concept, so therefore there's no real central idea to hold on to, and there's nothing, no focus for, like, no centralized focus for an idea to hold up to or to look up to, you know, it's...
Well, it is important mm-hmm. to identify as atheist so that you can get out of the religious conference and mm-hmm. have people reporting the demographic that we are the fastest rising, and we are one of the most significant demographics already, outnumbering all of these other religious groups. While that is important, you're right. It doesn't actually offer anything. Humanism offers a humanitarian aspect that's moral and respectable, and certainly science offers understanding of something that's really real, right? These are the things that I advocate for.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I have to also bash religion because I'm an anti-theist, and I see when you weigh out all the positives and negatives, religion still ends up being a net negative against humanity, and has always only retarded or reversed or impeded all progress in every application it has ever touched. I have to take the negative and the positive. Yes.
What's your sense on what Trump is doing to religion? Because I know in the Republican Party, of course, there's a split, and then you have with the churches, you have some of the prominent leaders backing him. There's these really wacky videos of these laying on of hands of Trump, of, you know, religious leaders on Trump, and all the hallelujahs and everything. And do you have a sense of? I mean, I think the internet is helping to kill off a lot of what religion has been doing. Do you think Trump is also doing that?
Yeah. Well, I think that Hillary Clinton was more successful in her use of religion than Trump is, because Trump has absolutely no idea what he's talking about, like, ever on any topic, and the Republicans kind of admit that, right? Because you've had a number of Republicans that refuse to endorse him because he doesn't know what's in 2 Corinthians, for example. And he says the Bible is his favorite book, but he can't name anything in it. It's like asking Gary Johnson to list off his world leaders. It's meaningless. I think that when you were talking about the number of people that turn out for that are impassioned activists in places like San Francisco, where it's very liberal, where it's very advanced culturally, right? Similarly, I noticed that when all the tours that I've done, the lowest population or the lowest turnout I've ever had anywhere was, strangely, repeatedly, New York.
Mm-hmm.
Why the fuck would it be New York when you have all those people there, right? Well, it's because they don't have religion being pushed on them the way they are in Mississippi or in Florida or in Texas or Louisiana. Those places turn out buckets of activists. So what will end up happening is, if we get somebody like Trump and his reprehensible VP choice to end up being our president, they will produce a hell of a lot of atheists
yeah.
in rapid fashion. And I'm not hoping for that, because Trump will, in my opinion, in my own little personal political opinion, I think Trump is permanent damage that we will never recover from. But Pence will easily make more atheists than I ever could.
Yeah. We'll get a lot more people at our meetings.
Yes, you will.
You know what? It's a little bit after 5.
Is it?
Thank you.
Yeah. Thank you, everyone, for turning out. I do have books for sale.
My books.